Hello, good evening, everyone. My name is Joey Reyes. My pronouns are they, them, and I am the line producer at Longworth Theater. Before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to recognize that Longworth Theater sits on the unceded territory of the Pogosit, Quinnipiac, and Wappinger peoples. As we begin today, we acknowledge that Indigenous peoples and nations have for generations stewarded the lands and waterways of what we now call the state of Connecticut. We honor and respect the enduring relationship that exists between these peoples and nations and this land. We remind ourselves that along with stolen land came stolen people. It is our responsibility to the future to know our past. If this is your first time joining us, welcome. The Lab is a free public event that takes place once a month and is made possible by the support of the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. These events are curated by local and national artists who are in residence at Longworth Theater, either in person or virtually. The subjects that are explored in the Lab are as dynamic as the artists that host them. This month, the Lab is curated by Longworth's Andrew W. Mellon Playwrights in Residence, Universes. Celebrating its 26th year, Universes is a national theater company of color dedicated to the creation, development, production, touring, community engagement, and educational dissemination of new theatrical and performance works for stage and screen. Led by its founders slash artistic directors, Stephen Sapp and Mildred Ruiz-Sapp, the core group of writers breaks the bounds of traditional theater, building on Universe's aesthetic and unique brand to invite and challenge old and new generations of theater crafters, as well as theater goers and newcomers to envision a new American theater. Tonight, you'll be hearing from Universe's and their collaborators, Laurie Woolery and Tony Taccone, as they give you a sneak peek into the creation of their newest work entitled Maria. Please use the chat to welcome Universe's and to express your enthusiasm throughout the program.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, everyone. How are you?
How's everybody?
We are thrilled to be here. Honored to be here, in fact. We have been commissioned by Longworth Theater to create a new work as Andrew Mellon Foundation Playwrights in Residence. And, we had many, many choices, many options, but of course, we landed on Maria, and we wanted to tell you a little bit about that, about kind of the what brought us to that, and what it's all about. So I am I'm Puerto Rican, New Yorican, but of Puerto Rican descent, and I'm a diasporican, I guess you would say, a New Yorican diasporican, all those Ricans, all of that. I am all of that. And Hurricane Maria devastated the island, and we were able to, you know, go home and try and save our folks. Steve, introduce yourself and tell about what you think here.
My name is Stephen Sapp, the other half of Universe is writing this particular piece. And this piece excites me because I grew up in New York City, and in New York City, Blacks or African Americans and Puerto Ricans grew up pretty much like this. So my together closely with Puerto Ricans. My father in particular spoke Spanish and made sure that that element was in the house as I grew up. So it's exciting to be journeying, you know, taking this journey with my married family for over 30 years. So I feel I'm excited about the possibilities and where we're going.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So when the hurricane struck, every Puerto Rican in the world was looking at the island. Well, aside from the fact, first of all, let's talk about the people that were on the island, more importantly than anybody else, who had to deal with the devastation of everything that they knew, the world that they knew, the island that they knew, their families, their friends, their animals, their homes, and everything just threatened. And no way out, right? You're in the middle of the ocean, like on an island, no way out. And understanding your relationship with the United States, also not sure if the US was gonna come through for you as the island's relationship with the United States is so complicated. So all of us on the outside also trying to reach into our families, reach to our homes, reach to our families and friends, trying to make those phone calls, trying to collect, you know, foods and clothings and emptying out our closets. I'm sure many of you were a part of that in trying to just figure out, what do we do? How do we help? So this was kind of one of those situations where the world was activated and we were watching it on TV people from news from all over the world. Just the lens was on Puerto Rico. And this is kind of where this project started, the need to say something. So one of the earlier, this is an early idea that we'd like to share with you. And it is a quick video. Joe, if you will just cue that up and play it, it'll be awesome. It's just going to give you a little idea of what my emotional state was when I returned from Puerto Rico after so many of you probably who gave us, you know, funds, who gave us, you know, solar powered lights to take to the island. All of you guys really galvanized around our efforts. And when we went, we delivered everything. We drove through little towns and just like delivered all the love that you guys sent. And this is kind of like when I returned, this was my feeling about what I saw and how I was feeling about the US. And so this is an early iteration of something. And we were like, it's not perfect. It's not ready. It's all in draft form. But we'd like to share that with you. So go for it, Joey.
The first pictures now coming in from Puerto Rico after taking a direct hit. Hurricane Maria slamming into the island, and as you heard, one official saying the island is destroyed.
Open up your eyes, break free and start to rise, wrapped in one star, five stripes. For home, for love, for life, for justice till I fight, cry freedom till I die. While Big Brother looks to recover what was never his, they embrace and hold on to one last kiss in the middle of big, big war. El Presidente tricks la gente gently, gives the paper towers for the levees, waving sun showers come down heavy in the middle of big, big weather. Llamen la sirena de los siete mares, que se levante y no cubra de todo mal. Huracán, 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 no tembales, con siete faltas, agua azul, perla blanca, te voy a derrotar. Mientras los políticos pelean, la junta se ajunta, aunque la isla se hunda, con privilegio y sin promesa se pasean. Los aguanta tras adelante, de adentro para afuera, con los pies para arriba y la cabeza para la acera, jamaquea, jamaquea, pero en bolsillo vacío no hay peseta. Llamen la sirena de los siete mares, que se levante y nos cubra de todo mal. Huracán, 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 no te embales. Un siete falta, agua azul, perla blanca, te voy a derrotar. She opened up her eyes, go free and try to rise. Wrapped up in one star, five stripes. American flag stars are witness to our scars. Should we wave it above the side or below ours? Dear America, God shed his grace on thee. I was not born in Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico was born in me. You promised me my freedom, but my mother still ain't free. Is self-determination real, or a life led to a colony? Llamen la sirena de los siete mares, que se levante y no cubra de todo mal. Huracán, 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 no tembales. Con siete faltas, agua azul, pela blanca, te voy a derrotar. While Big Brother looks to recover what was never his, they embrace and hold on to one last kiss in the middle of big, big water. El presidente tricks la gente gently, gives the paper towels for the levees, waving sun showers come down heavy in the middle of big, big water. Llamen la sirena de los siete mares, que se levante y no cubra de todo mal. Huracán, 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 no te embales,
Con siete faldas azul, pela blanca te voy a derrotar. We've opened up our eyes, for free and sun to rise. Wrapped up in one star, our stripes. Mejores que mi berinquen, sea libre y soberana, porque la estrella de mi bandera no cabe en la americana. Oh, I'm one of life, for justice till I fight, cry freedom till I die.
No está disponible. Cuando escuche el tono, por favor, grabe su mensaje. Al terminar su mensaje, marque el 1.
So that is a little glimpse into some of the thoughts that we were discussing when we came back from the island. There's a shout out in there to Maria Fernandez, Mariposa, who always said, yo no nací en Puerto Rico, Puerto Rico nació en mí. So we both put that in there. I was not born in Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico was born in me. So we tried to include all of those conversations, and that particular sound of the message not going through was the thing that devastated probably the diaspora the most. Not like just hearing this voice. Su llamada ha sido enviada a un mensaje electrónico de voz. It's like, it was killing us. It was killing us. So we wanted to incorporate that in here as well. Now, this is just an example of some of the things we're playing with, but I'd like for Steve to tell a little bit of what the impetus or what really got us on this journey of Maria to bring it into a bigger story, into a bigger narrative.
Well, the original idea, the first inspiration for this piece came with, you know, everyone knows West Side Story and the infamous, incredible piece that it is, and complicated. But it was taking a look at what happened to that young woman, Maria, after she walks out of that park, after Tony's been murdered. What is her life like after that? What life does she lead now that she knows hate and murder and all those things in her life that's not part of her life now? Where does her story continue to go on and be an older woman in Puerto Rico during Hurricane Maria? So that was the original sort of
one of the inspirations.
Yeah, yeah, was who was this young woman? What happened to her? Yeah. Is the question that we started, that we wanted to sort of unpack.
And you know, my parents are of the second wave of Puerto Ricans coming into the mainland. But they also kind of had those similar hopes and dreams of wanting to, you know, make it here. And then the realization of what it means to make it here, what it means to have to survive here as a Puerto Rican, fresh off the island and raising kids here, and like all of that experience. So we really want to use every inspiration that we have to bring us to this place. Like, you know, if Maria, what happens to her? What happens to parents, those young people who came here once they got off, stepped off of the plane, stepped out off of the ship? You know, like, what is it? What does life, what happens? And then what is life like living here in the United States for all those times? Or did they go back home? The dream of every Puerto Rican is to go back to the island. And let's take our Maria and place her within the eye of the storm, place her at Hurricane Maria, place her in that moment, that place in time where she has to take notice of everything that she's lived, everything that has happened to her at this moment where life is on the balance. So that's where we are. We're, you know, how do we celebrate it? How do we crash up against it? How do we create a storm of what it is to be of the island itself, right? So even if we took our lens off of the people, how do we place it on the island itself? So yeah, I think that's probably taken up a little bit more than the time we were allotted for a presentation. Yeah. But Joey, you know, so you can guide us through this as how we introduce Tony and Laurie, and I'm sure we have plenty of things to say together.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you for that context and for that background. I'm just going to go ahead and bring Tony and Laurie on now. Hello, welcome. So a little bit of context to share with the audience. We actually were all together in a room last week for a couple of days, starting the development of this piece. And I mean, you all are just so incredible. It was such an honor to be in that space with you all, and who are so not unfamiliar with the development of new work. All people have to do is Google your names and they'll know immediately. So I wanted to start off with a question on what is it about finding like the right collaborators when wanting to bring in a new piece? And then of course we have Tony and Laurie here with us. You know, what was it that made you think of their names and then wanting to bring them onto this project in particular?
Okay, so I mean,
revenge.
could be revenge. I mean, just knowing who these two individuals are, anybody would just be like, duh, right? But can you imagine being able to collaborate with Laurie and with Tony in this way? We've known them both for ages, right? And just kind of in passing and crossing and in collaboration. Laurie has directed some amazing works. We're literally calling from Ashland, Oregon right now. We've seen Laurie's work throughout the country. We've seen it at Ashland or at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. We've built a relationship with Laurie of love and friendship and sisterhood and, you know, siblinghood, that I think, you know, when we were having the initial conversation with Jacob, you know, he was like, well, who would you like to work with? You know, we were like, well, I mean, and at the moment he was thinking of designing a season around all women directors. And we were like, well, Laurie Woolery, of course, you know, so that's where that jumped off. And then we started to really investigate what it was that we wanted to do. And we were working on Party People. We had worked on Party People, and it went to Berkeley Rep, where Tony was the artistic director. And one of the experiences that we had here at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival as well was that Tony was able to kind of sneak in dramaturgically and slap us in the, you know, bottom and say, all right, this is what you got to do with that particular piece, or let's shape this, how, let's have, you know, asking amazing questions and challenging what we thought we wanted to create or how we wanted to keep things, right? Because sometimes you feel like, this is perfect. What are you talking about? I love this. I'm going to deliver it this way. And then you have someone that comes and just asks that perfect question and says, well, what about or why or explain? And then you have to challenge your ideas. So I think that, you know, bringing Tony in, also Tony's Puerto Rican, y'all. You know, it's like, hey, you know, we need a Puerto Rican on this project. So we're like, let's get Tony in this room. And also because even at the moment we were talking about West Side Story, but thinking about that duality, even like, you know, you have this, you know, possibility of, you know, race mixing and like all kinds of things. And to that, just like, who are we as a people and how do we feel about what we want to tell?
And having, and to be honest with you, having good energy in the room, good space around us. When we, I don't say we pick people, but when we end up with folk, we watch them for a while. And it's not just artistically, it's about who people are as people. Can you have a conversation and really kind of be with people as human beings first and foremost? And then the artistic collaboration kind of works after that. So for us, it's really about finding good people and who you want to hang out with and kind of go like, oh, wow. And we're doing, you know, and we're doing theater at the same time. That's cool. So that means a lot to us.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Before I move on, I want to note really quick for the audience that if our audience has any questions a little bit later, just throw them into the chat and we can be sure to try to get to those as well for any of our artists here. So feel free to drop those in the chat or in the comments section. Tony and Laurie, hello, welcome. Now I want to turn it towards you. When you received the invitation to become part of this team, what were your thoughts and what made you so eager to jump onto the project?
You mean I have to talk? I don't get to just hear nice things about me. That's pretty amazing. I first was introduced to universes up in Blue Lake through a network of ensemble theaters conference, and they were performing, and they floored me. Like, just what they were doing, I had not seen it before, I had not heard it before, and I was in awe. I just was totally, completely in awe of them, and just became a fan, an instant fan. And so then having the pleasure of developing a friendship, like, you're absolutely right, Stephen and Mildred, that it was like continuing to see their work and continuing to support it, and, you know, secret little hidden dream, like, oh my God, it'd be so amazing to work with them, you know, because I feel like what they do can challenge me as an artist, and I want to take on projects that ask me to step even farther outside of anything I've done before. And so that leads to, like, first of all, just being totally honored, loving the idea behind what this story could be, being able to go, like, how do we tell this story? How do we tell this story? Because a story has been told, and not completely, but how can we tell the story through universe's perspective? You know, how can the story be told in only the way that universes can tell it? And that became super intriguing to me. And then Tony, it's like, my God, it's like Tony Taccone. Like, yes, can I be in a space with Tony? And we've been very fortunate to be able to be in some, like, I looked at Tony from afar and admired Tony from afar and dreamed of working with Tony from afar, but then to be able to be fortunate during this time, the last 2 years, to be in spaces where Tony and I are not working on a project, but just talking bigger about, like, theater. And I was like, oh my gosh, I think we're kind of like cousins, like, just the way we speak directly to something. And I feel really excited to be able, we have this similar sense of humor and irreverence. And so it just feels like it's been bliss the last week to be able to spend with each other, getting to know each other as people, as artists, but just like, how do we want to birth this project? How do we want to set it up? What questions are we asking? So that, that felt really, feels really great. It's kind of like we have an idea of where we're going, but work transforms. And I'm excited to see the evolution of the piece and of our relationship together. Tony?
I just want to say that the lighting on Laurie is just unbelievably spectacular. It's just like, I don't know what, you've got a special lighting guy working on your Zoom thing.
David Wiener's in the corner lighting me.
Just to not to take up a lot of time with this, but I go way back with universes. I have always been trying to expand the definition of what theater is for a large audience. And these guys came out of the spoken word tradition that I loved, and they're colleagues with a number of close associates of mine, and I think I saw Slanguage back in the day and came within a nanosecond of doing it like at the rep, but that didn't happen, much to Steve's chagrin. He's been pissed off at me for like 20 years for that. As a producer and as just a colleague, as an admirer of people who have a kind of urgency to the work, a kind of propulsive, passionate, dynamic, personal energy around the work, I just felt like these guys are special, and so I've been always proud to be able to call themselves to call myself a friend and a supporter and a producer and a dramaturg in this case with these guys. And so, you know, when they first came to me with the idea of being, you know, involved as a dramaturg and just saying, the story, like, is a hook. Well, what happened to Maria after West Side Story? Right away, you're like, okay, that's interesting. And we sort of, because you have an immediate kind of intuitive narrative that sort of pops up. I mean, it's disjointed and it like it isn't resolved, but something happens to you with that. But then, of course, and I don't, you know, we're very, very early in the process of this conversation. So, and it's a little risky, honestly, doing this, you know, now, because, you know, you don't want to speak too publicly when you're creating something in its formative stages, because you it kind of reduces it in some way. You're sort of talking ahead of yourself as if, oh yeah, this is our idea and here's how it's going to go. Like when in fact you kind of have no idea. We're just kind of like plumbing the depths. But we did get through recently with like 3 days with each other, which was super fun. And from my viewpoint was very successful because it kept asking the same question, which is, what story are you trying to write? What's underneath the idea? Where are the tentacles of the story going? And I think for each of us, Laurie brought this, I think, really consistent perspective of what's happening to her as a woman. What are the contradictions involved with that? I was interested in like what's the political, well, we all were, but what's the overall political sort of global view of what's happened to that island known as the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, whatever that is. And that's a very, very complicated, messy, interesting, fascinating subject. And so, of course, what it got down to was on the second day, Mildred kind of spinning off about her family. And it was kind of random. It wasn't like, let's talk about your family. It's like she just kind of spun out at the end of about 48 hours into like this kind of monologue about she at a party with her family and this. And then she's kind of sort of acting out these characters. We're going, and so she got done and she kind of went through the whole gamut of emotions. And I think Laurie and I just kind of went, well, there you go. Well, there you go. I mean, that's what I think right there. There was this kind of aha moment of like, this is what's under the story. It felt like an immediately like dramatic story with a lot of different viewpoints, a lot of different personal stakes. And the idea that the one idea emerged really grippingly that we all really latched on. I even forget who said it. But the idea that you had a whole group of people who were fighting over a piece of property that they didn't even own. And that felt like very rich for all of us. Felt like, oh, that is emblematic of a personal stake in something, a national stake in something. And it was rife with everyone's different viewpoints about where they were coming from, what level of ownership they had over not just the piece of property, but over their identity and how that fed into it. And it was also funny and celebratory and tragic and sad and filled with a lot of stuff. So that's, we just kind of ended up circling around that. And it was super, it was cool. And so we just left going, okay, Mildred, good luck. And we'll see you in 2 years when you have a draft.
Yeah, I think that it's, you know, every writer, you know, has to dig into themselves at some point to try to find some of the crazy people in their life and see how they've influenced or impacted their lives. And, you know, all of us have these same exact characters. That's one of the great things when we were in the room together, we were actually comparing notes like, oh yeah, I got one of those Theas and I got one of those Theos and I got one of those cousins. Oh yeah, you know, and my mother and my father. So that was what made it so exciting that it was like, you know, even though we want to kind of, what I walked away thinking was, even though I want to kind of put it into these little boxes, right? Or really talk about this particular thing or universalize a thing a certain way, you know, it doesn't always have to be that way. And if the more universal the story can be, the better it is, you know? And the more like, you know, if it's a family gathering, everybody has those. Everybody knows the clowns that show up. Everybody knows what happens at the end of the night. So it's kind of like, that was the experience we walked away with, like, man, how do we make this an experience where people can arrive at their family home? You know, even the audience, like, let's say that the audience has arrived at the gathering, you know, and just knowing where things are and who's going to come and serve you and who's going to make you feel a certain way and who's going to push your button, who's going to be the trigger the second they walk through into the room. And who were those triggers for so many Marias? So many Marias on this planet, right? So many, and from every culture, every background, right? All those young girls who are starry-eyed, right? Like my mom was, like my grandma was, like so many of our, you know, moms were, right? They arrive and they have this hope and dream and starry-eyedness to what it is that they wanna believe. And then the world happens, and then these characters arrive, and then you have to deal with all of it in a nutshell. And then at the end of the day, you know, you think back at like your, you know, like I think about my grandma, right, who passed away. Both of my grandmas have passed away, but it's like at the end of their life, you know, where were they with the choices that they made, with the people that they interacted with? And of course I can't go back and ask them this. I do not have that privilege, right? So if you do have that privilege to go to your grandma and say, you know, how are you feeling about these things, do it. Which was one of the conversations we were having with Joey too, right? Like we were like, Joey, you have that aunt. You better go and talk to your aunt and get those juicy stories. So I think that that's that place where you start to like really investigate, like, is this even worth it? You know, like Puerto Rico has always been, the island itself has been in this constant struggle and fight. Like Tony was saying, fighting for a land that, you know, fighting for land that doesn't belong to you, fighting for a citizenship that doesn't belong to you. You're kind of like straddling these two worlds. You're in the middle of it all. Will they come save us? Will they not? Like it's just, you know, and I was telling Laurie, it's this, it's that kept woman relationship, you know, like Puerto Rico is that woman that is put in that special apartment and taken care of and, you know, used and abused and, you know, and then when it's all over, she has to move out of that apartment. That's not hers. It's not hers. It doesn't belong to her, you know? So those are some of the conversations that we were having as we were kind of diving into like, well, how do we want to make this different or more interesting or more universal, you know, so that people don't just look at it as a Puerto Rican story or, you know, a Black story. Like, it's like, how does it make people feel about their own stories?
And also, I mean, since this is the beginning of processing, this is what this conversation is about, partially. It's this part is actually, I don't say the most fun, but it's like, ooh, it's like you have an empty canvas and you're really just beginning to kind of throw up some colors and see what works and throw that on the wall and see what works, and really leaving it open. And a lot of our stuff actually just, you know, like, you know, we were saying, we were sitting around for 48 hours and all of a sudden Mildred just sort of unloads this whole monologue.
Oh, Lord.
I mean, a lot of our stuff is sort of, we're hanging around and we're having conversation and allowing that process, that idea of communion, just being around folk. And out of that, being that relaxed, comes the work. So this is a great time now just to like, okay, what if? And really kind of allow ourselves with cool people to go on the what if journey.
I will add one thing that I think we also discovered is creating in a different way for you all, because that you've spoken before that what you normally do is the songs come really easy and that you're able to like write a bunch of songs and kind of collage it into a narrative, and that what we're really talking about this time is knowing that, okay, that's your superpower. So we're not going to lead with that right now. We're actually going to lead with the story.
Yeah.
And figure out what that is. And I think that that's very exciting and also incredibly vulnerable, because it's like, I can feel you, Mildred. You're just like, ah, I'm really exposing myself in a way that I haven't before. And I think that that is exactly where we need to be as artists. And it's just very exciting.
I'm sorry, my dog started barking. It's horrible. Just as you were talking about how vulnerable I am. I mean, it is a vulnerable place. And not just for yourself, though, because you also have to, you know, kind of protect the stories of the people you've come across or people who you might be creating a story completely just like, you know, fictional, but it's going to impact somebody a certain way, you know? And if they're sitting in that audience and if they're carrying that trauma, you know, you're responsible for how they walk out of that room, you know? So I feel like, you know, even as we discuss it, it's like, man, we have to be careful and caring of the people that are going to receive these stories of, you know.
And the vulnerability is why we come to this anyway, is to be vulnerable. So again, it's finding those collaborators where you can truly be vulnerable. And kind of, it's always the point where someone goes, so what do you want to do? And you kind of go like, I don't know. It's a great answer to me, because it's kind of to actually say it out of your mouth in a room and not kind of like, well, it's about this and we're doing this and yeah. But to kind of go like, I really don't know. And for the people to be like, okay, we all don't know together. And then you begin to build from there is actually, again, the most fun to me. So like you said, our superpower, we know where to go with that. But it's like, you know, let's be in the room and really kind of find it. Like what this, you know, this album is not going to sound like that album, so to speak. So it's like, we're going to find the sound in the room, which is exciting.
I will say, having what I consider to have been like a fly on the wall, essentially, just being in observance of the generative nature of just having the four of you together and sort of riffing off of each other, and also speaking very much to the fact of just like the relationships that you have with one another. It's so incredible to witness, and like the container that gets created in order to express that vulnerability and have everyone feel comfortable to share those stories that really like hit close to home. I mean, quite literally with family. And sort of being able to trust each other and hold each other in that uncertainty of this process that is so, you know, and it's sort of like not even birthing, but just sort of like in its conception still, you know. I wonder too, you know, we had our fixed amount of time together in the space, and then obviously, you know, in between those fixed amount of times, you all were universes were very busy, you know, putting things together. And so in my head, I'm just like, what does that look like? Or what was that process like? What is your writing process like when you're starting to like pull those pieces together, coming off of these conversations that we've had, these amazing, beautiful, wonderful conversations, and then sort of throwing this together and starting to storyboard what this potentially could look like?
I think for me, my writing process is, it's a little bit of everything. So it could be a joke. It could be half of a story and you just kind of document it. I may write a line. I may get eight lines of a poem. I may get a riff of a song, and you kind of just keep it. You put it on the side, you put it on the side, you put it on the side. And then we constantly talk and retalk about what is it, what can it be? So on Tuesday, it'll be this, and you'll be like, yes, this is what I know what it is. And then we'll wake up the next morning and we'll just go, so what are we doing? And then it's like, it all starts, the conversation starts again, which is exciting and frustrating all at the same time. But it's really just trying to catch snatches of things, what you hear. If there's a scene, write it, but if not, write what you hear. And what you're feeling, and then you can make that part work. So you may be living with something for a month, 2 months, that doesn't have a voice, it doesn't have a character, it doesn't have anything, but you've been living with it because you wrote it right after one of our meetings. We're driving back in the car, and I'm like, oh, I gotta remember that Laurie said this and Tony said this, and I'm gonna just riff on that and then just hold it. Mm-hmm. And then when we're beginning to put things together, you can match the new ideas that are coming out with those things that you initially heard. And it's just one big giant gumbo, I think is the best way to describe it.
I think Steve is always walking around with his notebooks and his pens, and like he'll hear something and he'll just go down like some kind of path and just start just brainstorming things. With me, it's more, I'm more of an audiovisual person. So it's about a lot of music and a lot of like, just like searching. I do a lot of research, right? Right now, this piece in particular, you know, I've done my ancestry. So I've been going down my ancestry family tree, just looking at, not even opening up their little, you know, pictures, but looking at the body of it, you know, and even seeing it as a shape, if that makes any sense, you know, and seeing where those branches are connecting or not, or seeing the color of people, right? Because that's a very real conversation that's happening in the United States right now, you know, about Black Puerto Ricans and like all of that. So it's like looking at the color palette in my own family tree as I put up different people's pictures and saying, wow, this person, you know, was dark skin and these were their kids and this is how that worked out. And this is how, you know, so I take a lot from that in even how I'm writing the rhythms, the music of things, the, you know, images, the, you know, sunset, like, and I try to bring a lot of that into what it is that I'm writing at the time, or I let it take me down a certain place. Like, you know, when Tony said, just go on a stream of consciousness, that was like, when he said that, I felt like permission, you know, to not really have to try to figure it out, but to just write whatever it is that came to mind. And then later on, dramaturgically, you know, this team will go and like find the gold nuggets in the middle of all those rocks that I carried into the room.
And just, I'm looking at the chat and there's a question from Sabrina Hamilton about visual images. There is a photographer who's from the Bronx, is a very good friend of ours. His name is David Gonzalez. And some of his pictures that he has taken over the years are legendary images of the Bronx, in Puerto Rican communities in particular. And so using and looking at David's photographs and having sort of David in the room has been amazing, all the way up into the Tats crew, mm-hmm. who are a graffiti crew in the Bronx also, and the images and how they look at New York City, you know, all these years later. Just two of the visual images that we have sort of in the room with us as we're creating this piece in particular.
I also want to add that I find this about storytelling overall, but I will just specifically talk about Mildred and Stephen and Tony when we were talking together, is storytelling is so visual. You know, when we were talking, what everyone was saying was creating images in my head already about, for example, Mildred and Stephen, you were talking about, I think it was you, Stephen, specifically talking about your childhood and about the family that moved in, and that how your grandmother related to them. She saw them as island people because she was an island person, and just how her gesture of seeing and recognizing different cultures, but seeing and understanding the experience of island to the States and the connection of food. I get chills now still just thinking about it, because that lended itself also to how we started like unpacking the story of events surrounding food and about being seen as opposed to being invisible or forgotten. And so I think themes also started coming up in storytelling of our own personal memory. So yes, it's not going to be like, definitely it's not going to be like the story of Mildred's family, you know, but it's starting from truth, and allowing that truth to expand and be made visible was definitely affected through the visual storytelling of our own personal experiences, which was really rich and really visceral. Like, you could taste the food, you could smell the ocean, you could feel the sand, the rain for it. Like, everything that you were talking about just made me think of like water and sweat and delicious food. So that felt very helpful as we were finding our way through.
Yeah, just to double down on that, you know, one of our jobs here, and this is a little bit of a challenge for both Laurie and I, because we're directors, and directors are basically people who, you know, fix problems, imagine a world, and get to it. And the job now is to actually to live with mess, to actually get as many visceral images and pieces of narrative or just fragments and throw them out there, and not to get too wedded too soon to, oh, this is an autobiographical story about Mildred's family. That's not what it's going to be. It will not be that. But the fact is that when Mildred did start to speak in very specific ways about specific people, suddenly that's the only way you get to the universal, is by being very specific. If you don't, when you start to, like, you know, try to create a universal story, that's when you get into real trouble, because then you start talking in, like, thematic terms, and you start telling the audience what the piece is about, as opposed to, you know, living inside of character and letting character reveal contradictions and unsolvable, unresolvable problems, you know, like, that are just easy to kind of, like, put a bow tie and go, here's the story. Right. So that's our job now, is to kind of just encourage Mildred and Steve to kind of, you know, widen the pool, if you will, of that they're digging through, and sort of, you know, make sure that they don't have too many rules right now to compromise where the story wants to go. And then, of course, at some point you have to go, like, OK, that was fine. But now we have to do something, because at some point the openness of what it could be becomes your enemy. It's like, oh my God, it could be anything. Now we got to pick something. But I do think that we did manage to, I think, both create a large arena, but also something that felt that it was personal and vivid. And as Laurie was saying, you could smell, taste, and feel things. And immediately you're like, you're grabbed by it. So instead of saying, like, a Maria West Side Story and then suddenly inventing a kind of fictional thing that was sort of random according to what ideas you wanted to have happen to her, so you could say what you wanted to say, you know, that's like a mechanistic, you know, very shallow pool to be drawing from, as opposed to, here's a group of people, God knows what they're going to do, because they're so full of contradictions and they're so full of brio and kind of, like people are, mystery. So it's a question of which characters to focus on, and then putting them in a situation which is both, you know, naturally, realistically, and metaphorically rich.
So yeah, and the gift of us being together, also, we're holding the conversations. So we, that will be threaded in throughout, like, jump cut to design, you know, jump cut to communities that we want to be part of the development of this. You know what I mean? Like, the whole us being here at the very, very, very beginning. This is where I just want to give a nod to this kind of process. It feels like European in the fact that it's like we have, I'm going to just say, like, it feels like a gift of time that, like, let's really birth it properly, you know, and that is not what always happens. It's like a director will get a script that has been written, and you know, any playwright that I've worked with, it's like, tell me your origin story. Like, I need to know the genesis of this. And they share it with me, but, like, now I get to be like, oh, remember? Like, I'm part of the genesis. Like, I get to be witness to all those ideas. And we will all, and the reason why Tony is so great to be a part of it is, like, I don't, he's going to hear things that I don't hear, and I'm going to hear things that he doesn't hear. And we're going to be able to partner, be really good midwives and yeah. husbands
yeah.
or whatever. I just made it all about gender, mid people, we're good, whatever.
We're doulas, baby. We're doulas.
We're doulas. That's it. Thank you. Woo. Got me out of that one. See, that was collaboration right there. We just modeled collaboration.
Amazing. Oh my gosh. It's just like, oh, I'm getting brought back into like the space that we were just in a week ago. It's like all that same energy is like still here, even in the virtual world. It's amazing. We're down to our last few minutes here. So I want to sort of end with this final question on not specifically on this project in particular, but you know, we're emerging or sort of reopening. We're still in an ongoing global pandemic, but the conversation in terms of theater making has just shifted so drastically over the last almost 2 years now. And even the concept, the idea of developing new work. And so I just want to ask you all to leave some parting words on like what your hopes are for the future of the American theater and new work and new plays as we continue to emerge from this.
I hope we survive. I hope we make it.
Yeah, right.
You know, I hope theaters are able to make it through. I hope artists are able to rise, you know, taller than the theaters themselves. I hope that, you know, we're able to, all the things we've learned, we've been learning a lot of things while we've been in this quarantine. You know, I'm hoping that we're able to incorporate all of that newness and those explorations that we've kind of taken ourselves through in our own little caves. I hope that we'll be able to bring that with us and keep it along the way, you know, and that people don't try to bring us back to the formulas. If that makes any sense,
and allow obviously there's a new paradigm that we're looking at right now. So how do you continue to evolve the work to continue to bring in models and methodologies that might not be traditional, and just get the right folks in the room to really just continue to bring these stories to the front, and having theaters that may look at these non-traditional voices in a different way in terms of providing resources and things like that to the party, because we have a whole lot more ways of being entertained now. So if you're coming to a live event with live people in the room, what does that continue to mean? That type of ancient storytelling, what does that continue to mean to people? And that's what is exciting for us to continue to be doing this for so long, for that live storytelling element is still extremely exciting.
Go ahead, Laurie.
Oh my gosh, go for it.
I just really simply hope we learn to rebuild trust in each other first, and respect. And I'm not so much worried about the love. Love always comes with for me after respect. So I know there's been a fracture across many different platforms, and I'm just eager to get back into a rehearsal hall with various folks and to rebuild trust.
And as always, my three brilliant collaborators said so much of what I was thinking. I want us to do it in a real healthy way. Like, may, as we're rebuilding new paradigms, can we really allow time to be our friend in creating this work that doesn't feel like there's a healthy pressure and then there is an exhausting pressure. Mm-hmm. And I think this is tied into like sustainability. I don't want the theater to lose our great artists, and I want our theaters to create space for our great artists emerging, that they don't leave and go elsewhere. And I'm also really excited about the potential of it all. So there is great hope, but an activated hope. Like, how can we model that in what we're doing now? Feels very, feels like I can't think of better people to be doing it with. So I'm honored and excited to be a part of it all. And Tony Wright, let the great work begin.
The great work begin.
Let's begin.
There it is. There it is. There it is. It had to come up at one point.
Yeah.
Tony, Laurie, thank you so much for being here with us. Mildred and Steven, thank you for the incredible work that you are doing. To everyone who's watching, thank you so much for joining us this evening. And we also have to shout out the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation that like gives us the support to make these things happen. We hope you all have a wonderful, wonderful evening. We will see you in December for our next lab, and have a good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.